Friends, what are the seven links to awakening? The seven Sambhuyangas. 1. Awareness is the link to awakening. Sati Sambhuyanga. 2. Investigation is the link to awakening. Vichaya Sambhuyanga. 3. Energy is the link to awakening. Virya Sambhuyanga. 4. Joy is the link to awakening. Piti Sambhuyanga. 5. Tranquility is the link to awakening. Pasati Sambhuyanga. 6. Concentration is the link to awakening. Samadhi Sambhuyanga. 7. Equanimity is the link to awakening. Upekkha Sambhuyanga. These are the seven links leading to final mental enlightenment. Friends, this Dhamma evaporates the mental hindrances. Unhindered is such elevation. The Blessed Buddha once said, when Bhikkhus, a noble disciple, listen carefully to the Dhamma, alert with keen ears, attending to it as a matter of crucial concern, indeed as something of vital importance, directing his entire mind to it. In that very moment, the five mental hindrances are absent in him. On that occasion, the seven links to awakening approaches complete fulfillment. And what are the five mental hindrances that are absent on that occasion? The mental hindrance of sense desire is all absent on that very occasion. The mental hindrance of ill will is all absent in this exact moment. The mental hindrance of lethargy and laziness is all absent during that period. The mental hindrance of restlessness and regret is all absent on that event. The mental hindrance of doubt and uncertainty is all absent in that interval. The five mental hindrances are thus entirely absent in that very moment. And what are the seven links to awakening that approaches fulfillment there? The awareness link to awakening develops toward complete fulfillment. The investigation link to awakening arises and approaches fulfillment. The enthusiastic energy link to awakening also pushes forward towards fulfillment. The joy link to awakening elevates and moves towards complete fulfillment. The tranquility link to awakening silently comes to a stealth fulfillment. The concentration link to awakening absorbs into one-pointed fulfillment. The equanimity link to awakening also gains fulfillment by development. These are the seven links to awakening that are fulfilled by development on that very occasion. When Bhikkhus, a noble disciple, listens carefully to the Dhamma, alert with keen ears, attending to it as a matter of crucial concern, as something of vital importance, directing his entire mind to it, on that very moment, the five mental hindrances are absent in him. On that occasion, the seven links to awakening develop towards complete fulfillment. At another occasion, a certain bhikkhu once asked the Blessed Buddha, "Venerable sir, it is said, clever and wise, in what way, Venerable sir, can one be rightly called clever and wise?" The Buddha then answered, "Bhikkhu, it is because one has indeed developed and cultivated these seven links to awakening that one rightly is called clever and wise." What seven? 1. The awareness link to awakening. 2. The investigation link to awakening. 3. The energy link to awakening. 4. The joy link to awakening. 5. The tranquility link to awakening. 6. The concentration link to awakening. 7. The equanimity link to awakening. It is because one has indeed developed and made much of these seven factors of enlightenment that one is called clever and wise. And these edited extracts are from the Connected Sayings of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Book 5, Section 46, on the Links to Awakening, the Sambuyanga, and is Sutta number 38, Unhindered, and Sutta number 5, Intelligent.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air number 81 on marijuana addiction, among other things, recorded in November 2017 on Nagas Mountain, Cypress Hermitage, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. There are three questions, one lotus offering and one Dhammasala report, but first, as usual, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. The lotus offering was given partly by myself and partly by a young man called Dan Ramesh living in Colombo, and it comes right here.
Hello to you, friends. This is a new flower offering, lotus offering from Mr. Dan Ramesh of Colombo, and these lotuses will now go and offer to Lord Buddha Tooth, which lies under the golden roof up there in a wonderful bright sunshine. Thank you. that some of this. Of the tooth. Det lyder mig, det gør mig. Candy. 2017. Definitely a nice place. A worthy place. Next Buddha's temple. Buddha Matea. Ajita Mateas. Who will come 576 million years. We'll go and make a small offering here also. If we see. Thank you.
So much for this very meritorious, very probability lifting gifts to the Lord Buddha's tooth relic inside Kandy in Dalila Maligava, the temple of the tooth. Here comes the Dhammasala report. I'd like to say thank you very, very much to those who have supported this meditation hall, this Bhavana Sala development, that their donations and support makes this construction ongoing, so we don't need to make any break. Thank you very much for the support to this Bhavanasala, this meditation hall construction, for the benefit of the many who come here to meditate in the future. And the construction report comes right here.
Hello to you, friends. This is just to update you on the meditation hall. The iron has been carried up here, and half of the sand. That's a significant part of the work, is to carry this sand, 35 kilos per bag, up here in 4,000 feet elevation, because there's no road access. Next up is a cement bag, 20 cement bags. So tomorrow we will start to bend these iron rods and make the armament for this wall that will be a part of the foundation, one quarter of the foundation for the meditation hall.
I just like to say then, thanks for your keen attention, clever consideration and kind contribution. We have just started building the meditation hall, which is very necessary because it's raining up here. It starts raining now, drizzling. And I'll make some video, there will come some video about it next week. But donations and support for this meditation roof for meditators that comes up here is very welcome still. And it's this, of course, enables them to approach Nirvana. And when you give somebody else the opportunity to approach Nibbana, then you get the very same thing back from the karmic mirror that reflects this good opportunity giving back to the donor. So this is worth remembering, giving others opportunity to reach deathlessness thereby increases one's probability and ability to gain this very same deathlessness, this very same Nibbana, this very same irreversible end of suffering, this very same lasting happiness oneself. Worth remembering is that Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa.
Actually, when working myself on this project of building a meditation hall, I feel a great satisfaction because I know I do something good for others. And when you do something altruistic, then you also feel a great satisfaction. You are like lighted up by an inner fire and become very happy and satisfied by doing this good. Knowing that many of the donors and many others also, of course, will come and meditate in this meditation hall for the next 20 years. This makes me very happy. So they can approach Nibbana. They can become more free, more happy, more peaceful, and have a greater insight into the absolute nature of reality.
This is the first place where the sand comes. It comes up, driving up this dirt road here, up the mountain. And then we offload it here. Then it's packed here into bags, 35 kilo bags, 100 bags. And then it's transported up to the first station, which is around there. And then from this station is carried up to the next station, which is around there, up there. And then it's carried for the third station up to the Bhavanakopi, which is up at the foot of this cliff. Significant work, a lot of sweat. That's a difficulty of building in the mountains. There's this difficult access for materials like sand and cement. Thank you.
So much for constructing this meditation hall, which I feel very happy about. It's being done here slowly, little by little. And of course, I'm looking forward to sitting in it myself day and night, and to have guests also that sits in it day and night and gain the benefit from mental development, refinement, and improvement caused and conditioned by this roof. The questions, question 241, approaching 250 questions. If a witness testifies against a murderer, which is then imprisoned lifelong, how does that affect the karmic future of the witness? It depends upon what the witness say. If the witness speak the truth, then it affects the witness karmic future in a positive way. If the witness does not speak the truth or hold back information, then it affects the witness' future in a negative way in the future. So the Buddha was very clear about that, about speaking the truth. It's when the king or the court summons one, then one should, if he asks, did you see that? Then she should ask, yes, I saw that. Or if he didn't see it, then one should answer, I didn't see it. I tell what you know, then one should tell what one knows. Do you know this and that? Then if one doesn't know it, then one should answer no. So it's a very clear cut in this situation where one is interrogated or scrutinized by others regarding what is the truth and what is not the truth. then one should stay with the truth, irrespective of how dangerous or detrimental it can seem on the short run. On the long run, then it will benefit one. And it also benefits society, that everyone, especially in court situations, but also on television, interviewed by journalists, interviewed by friends, that everybody speaks the truth in this regard. This, then one can trust the world. As soon as everybody doesn't speak the truth, then one cannot trust the world. Then the world becomes dangerous. One cannot trust what people say. The Buddha was very clear about what it means to be a liar, to not speak the truth. And modern psychology says that humans at the current time level where morals have decayed significantly, they lie 5 times a day. They found out by looking into people's life with cameras in their home and on their video cameras in the home or on the job, and then finding out what they say, and then counting how many times they lie, checking out the truth of these statements, and then counting up. So they come from to an average of 5. And this is 5 too much. 5 too much per day. This, the kammic accumulation of that lifelong is catastrophic. It's not it's almost, in almost all cases, it's not associated with human rebirth. It means downfall to animal level or lower than that. So this very popular, and today it seems like, it doesn't matter. Well, it does matter. First you lose your reputation, you only lose that once. And at the moment of death, then you lose your human state. Very difficult to come back. Very, very difficult, almost impossible. So speak the truth. As the Russians say, speak the truth, eat bread and salt. And that's some dry, forceful rationalism in this. It's common sense. It's one of the 5 precepts, huh? Not to musavada, not to speak false and deceive the world. Knowing it is like this and then expressing it either verbally or with some kind of nonverbal expression, say it's like this, or express it like this, or communicate it like this. Knowing very well is like this, it's like A, one, communicate it's like B. For this or that trifle advantage for oneself or somebody else. This one should stop immediately. It is by no means innocent or ineffective. It is cutting one down, slice by slice, lie by lie, little by little. Buddha say very clearly that man is born with an axe in his own mouth, whereby he cuts himself down. Again, the Buddha said, man is born with an axe in his mouth, whereby he cuts himself down. Primarily by lying, but also by harsh speech, aggressive speech, slandering, gossiping, divisive speech about others. This one has to control this speech, what comes out this mouth. As soon as it's come out the mouth, then it cannot be retracted. Very difficult. You have to go and tell, I told a lie. Maybe those who told a lie, they disappeared into the world. You cannot find them again. Then it's irreversible. It cannot be reversed. You cannot get the information inside the mouth again. It's impossible. Huh? A lie is a lie. The table counts. And so the future is polluted right there. Question 242. In daily practice, should we share merit with the devas, and how should we do it? In daily practice, one should share merit with all beings. The devas actually doesn't need it that much as the animals do. And those are on the lower levels, like a angry demon, hungry ghost, or even hell being. So one should share merit with everyone. How is it done? One do it like determination. Whatever merit I earned for that, for this or that good doing, this I will share with all beings. whatever merit I already have learned upstream in my entire samsara, this I hereby share with all beings there are. May they get a fair share of that. One's own probability doesn't diminish because this giving away of one's probability to others and sharing merit with them, this is also an act of giving itself. So this increases also the probability. So one cannot lose this merit by sharing it with others. So once you share merit with everybody, all the time, not only the devas. I will say, it's better to share merit with somebody who need it more. That is, those at the subhuman levels, animal levels, ghost level, demon level, and hell level. They need it badly. And now to the main question. Question 243, how to battle my vana? Yes, my vana is a widespread, humongous vice that has become partly been innocent because the organic defects is not like in alcohol where you lose your brain and your liver and you die from it. And I like to say with alcohol, we have treated this before in another Dhamma on air, but 3 million people die every year from alcohol-related organic failure. 3 million people every year. It's still, if when I look at it as a doctor, it's wonder how can this be legal? You know, if there was a war and 3 million people were killed in 1 year, then everybody, all nations, they would go together and say, this war we have to stop immediately, by this way or that way, immediately. Because 3 million people is a humongous amount. But because legislators and people in general are very addicted to this alcohol abuse, which is very difficult to come out of. It's not like marijuana abuse where there's no physical dependence. There is physical dependence in alcohol abuse. And when you have passed this threshold, if you stop drinking, then you become sick and get a disease called delirium tremens, shakes and high fever, and then you die in less than 3 days if you don't get alcohol or some other psychoactive drug like benzodiazepines or other sleeping medicine. So untreated, this disease, delirium tremens, has a 80% mortality. So this explains when alcohol addicts have passed a certain stage, then it's a path of no return. They have to go to the doctor, get medicine. And very few of them do. Very few of them do. So they usually just drink for 20 years and then they die of it. This accounts for these 3 million deaths a year. Family horrors, economic deroute, everything falls apart with intoxication. And that goes for any intoxication. I've got a specific request on this marijuana addiction, so I'll speak a little bit about this. How to come out of it. First of all, I would say it's relatively easy to come out of if we compare to alcohol and to morphica, like morphine, or to something like cocaine. So people in general have a good prognosis if they can make the insight that this is necessary to stop this completely. How do you stop it? How do you stop any addiction? It's by seeing the dangers. We can divide the dangers of marijuana use up in two. Those are in the present life and those are the future life. If we take the future life first, this goes for any intoxication. What is the kammic probability effect of deliberately making yourself intoxicated, unhinged, to some degree mad? It is future risk of insanity, usually of the chronic kind, but can be also short-term. If the addiction has been short-term, the future mental disease will also be short-term. But if it's long-term addiction, lifelong, then there will be something like schizophrenia, severe depression, suicide in the future life. So while one is smoking joints here in this life or billowing booze, then one becomes a crackpot schizophrenic in a future life, jacking up the probability little by little. In this life, it's the same to some extent, because both with alcohol abuse and also marijuana abuse, there's an increased risk of getting a severe mental disorder later in life. That is schizophrenia, anxiety, depression. Whether it's caused by marijuana or whether there's a genetic predisposition to get these diseases is unclear at the moment. But it doesn't matter because the single user don't know whether he has the genetic background to become schizophrenia later in life. If then smokes, then he will debut with depression or schizophrenia or anxiety right now. And he maybe not, if he don't smoke, then he maybe never see the disease, even though we have the genes for it. So it doesn't count as an argument. Then there's memory loss on the short and on the long term. Loss of intelligence, 6 to 8 points, as has a recent examination in New Zealand for chronic users done. And you don't regain it if you start smoking as a teenager, early in teenage years, and have been a heavy smoker since then. Then you don't regain your intelligence after stopping smoking marijuana. Those who start late in life, they can regain their intelligence after they stop smoking, but it takes 3 months. Marijuana cannabinol is very lipophilic. It's smoking in the, it goes into the brain. There it resides for 3 months after going up because it has a very low half-life. So you accumulate it in the brain and it comes very slowly out. And these memory deficits, learning disorders, memory deficit, and then carelessness and laziness, they will then hang on for 3 months after a complete abstination. Then they will, the effect will hang on 3 months if one has started late in life. If started early in life, then one, these memory defects are irreversible. It's the chronic pothead. Everybody knows them in the West, and I think also here in the East. They are not very intelligent. They cannot remember much, and they cannot learn anything because they cannot remember. In whatever degree one smokes, the level of performance goes down. So one's professional performance, personal performance, social performance goes down. Because one becomes this kind of like little bit lazy and one becomes unaware of what is going on. One loses impulse control. So one starts eating more and one cannot impulses for anything else goes down. So you just follow your impulses. You cannot control yourself. Then there's this marijuana disorder, which is now a well-defined disease. If one looks at the scanning, then brain volume goes down, and some levels inside the brain, a center called hippocampus, which is the primary center for learning and memory, this goes down. The functioning of this hippocampal area in the brain goes down, and this accounts for the learning abilities goes down. And the memory abilities goes down. This is, of course, a danger. If we look at the social functioning, then there will be family problems, friendship problems, mistrust, and dependent behavior. That's kind of like a dead end because if you use alcohol, then you'll also tend to use more alcohol, or medications, or other drug abuse. So one abuse leads to another abuse, and then they enhance the effect. So there will be employment problems and thereby economic problems, educational problems, occupational problems, housekeeping problems. You cannot wash the clothes. The gardening doesn't do well. Housing problems. The house falls apart. Negative emotions, depressed mood, generalized anxiety, anger, guilt, and shame. Paranoia towards other people's expectations of what other people think and say about oneself is completely unrealistic and overblown. Negative emotions, depressed mood, generalized anxiety, anger, guilt, shame, bad consciousness, reality impairment, grandiosity that one thinks one is a super duper hero while one is just a pothead, basically. Reality distortion. And severe disorganization. One's room becomes a mess. One's professional life becomes a mess. One's private life becomes a mess. Intellectual functioning goes down. Distractibility, apathy, forgetfulness. Impaired executive functioning. Impaired social communication. repetitive fixative behavior, one do the same thing over and over again, personal neglect, slow psychomotor, one moves slowly, conclusion and lack of insight. So of course, these problems are severe, and they spill over to whatever evil, negative, wrong behavior one does while intoxicated, to the kammic future. So it causes a significant impairment in academic and occupational functioning. One becomes quarrelsome and critical, suspicious and withdrawal socially, likes to be alone while smoking, intoxicated behavior, driving, bad driving, dangerous risk-taking, irresponsibility, impulsivity, marital neglect or child neglect, legal problems. So all these problems are caused by those who are dependent upon, addicted to marijuana smoking, which is actually a form of sense pleasure, sense craving. Craving for the mental states of one's opioid systems is also involved. So one gets kind of like a slight calming in the way of opioids, morphine or opium gives. And because of this, one becomes addicted to it. And one keeps going back to it. I was calm and cozy yesterday because I smoked marijuana. Today I'm stressed. As a withdrawal symptoms of I didn't smoke today, I smoked yesterday. So now I go back and smoke again. So it repeats itself. The effect of calm is there. It lasts some hours. But then stress comes the next day. Anxiety, unrest, restlessness comes the next day. And then one, this gives an impulse to repeat the smoking again. With all kinds of addiction, whether it's addiction to sex or to food or to marijuana smoking or to alcohol drinking or whatever sense pleasure it is, music listening, bad TV shows listening, porn, movie looking and so on, any kind of sense craving, sense desire, kamachanda, it arises when thought goes to the object, when there's contact with the object, usually by thinking about it. Just one short associative thinking or memory about marijuana, then one will have craving for it again. And the Buddha say, where does it then cease, this sense craving? Right where it arises. It is arises where when one feels a craving and identify, becomes aware of it that it's craving, then one should be strong and say no by seeing these dangers I just mentioned. There's not only the mental dangers that we talked about. There's also, if you smoke a lot, then you get chronic bronchitis. There's proven to be a connection between marijuana smoking and a special kind of testis cancer in males. So it also affects the body. Not only does it ruin the mental function, it also ruins the body. So there's increased risk of a heart attack, probably around 5 times the normal risk of heart attack, because it puts up pulse and puts up blood pressure at the same time so that you're smoking. So the risk for heart attack, stroke, 5 times normal. Risk for getting a testis cancer that is malignant, that is to say will metastasize and eventually kill the person, is also increased. So, all in all, one should be able to say no. How does it come? How does one become able to say no? First of all, we're knowing this, that the craving ceases right where it arises. It is right at the moment of thinking about smoking joints that one should say no. Of buying joints. Or when somebody, friends start to smoke, one should leave. It's right there one should say no. As soon as you fall into this behavior of not saying no, not being able to say no, then the future goes down the drain. Inevitably, for all. There are some who postulated, and this is usually the hippie postulate, that you can get some kind of spiritual enhancement out of intoxication with either psilocybin or marijuana or any kind of drug. That's not the case. If that was the case, then you could see some of these old post-hippies being enlightened, and that's never the case. Post-hippies are usually kind of very low-key. And when they look back about their smoking in the youth, then they will usually admit to themselves and others that they lost their youth and lost their abilities to do something higher than they are able to do now. This is because of this learning ability defect that is coming with marijuana use, which is long-term and chronic if one starts and is a heavy smoker since the teenage years. So meditation will, if one can do meditation instead, then one can induce the same calm that one gets from marijuana smoking. And this one can induce with one breath. Then it's already there. One breath. No side effects. Increased ability to think, remember, and learn. One breath. How to do it is, again, seeing the dangers right where the memory of marijuana smoking comes up. And then say no. Never give up. One will fall back and have relapses time after time again. They should not give up and then throw the whole thing out and say, I will stop the battle against this vice, against this self-destruction. No, one should continue the battle. And little by little, one will increase one's ability to say no and then stay on this decision to say no, not to smoke again. And eventually one will come out of it. So one will have a period of 1 week without smoking, of 2 weeks without smoking, of 2 months without smoking, of 6 months without smoking, of a year without smoking, and then one has passed it. It's easy because the body don't need marijuana like it needs alcohol and morphine. They get physical symptoms. So marijuana is only mental symptoms, like irritability, lack of sleep, restlessness. But these can be overcome by meditation. So it's relatively easy, but no addiction is that easy. It's that easy. But one should focus on these dangers again and again and again. Focus on the dangers and then know it is right when this very short decision to say yes to go and smoke a new point, or to say no and not do it, not buy anything new. And then looking at all these potheads and see their future, see their stagnation, see their laziness, see their physical decay, see their social decay, mental decay, economic decay, intellectual decay, future decay, future destruction, basically. There's no advantage of any intoxication whatsoever. The Buddha was very clear on it, and I think it's so true. Don't affect the mind, because the mind has to cope with the world unintoxicated. So whatever you have to learn to cope with the world and to eventually escape the world by first becoming noble and then going to Nirvana, this cannot be done by intoxication. It can only be done by being both clear and calm. And that clearness, together with the calmness, will improve insight. And the insight, the understanding of insight, that the world basically is suffering. This will induce, eventually, the escape from the world. And thereby also the need for calming and intoxication. Thank you. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, indeed. Lastly, I again like to, from the bottom of my heart, say thank you to all the supporters, the donors and the Dayakas who provides food and who provides funds for the meditation hall, and also them, especially them who provide some small amount every month So there's a budget that can be used for cameras and outer equipment and new computers to do video editing and all kinds of things. Thank you. May all beings become happy by this effort and have a nice and noble day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.